tools and leadership. And he said that he would be honored to, and we're thrilled to death to have him tonight to do the teaching. So if you have your sheets, she has sent those sheets out to you. So hopefully you already have them, and you can either have printed them off or print them off now, or look at it if you have a phone one look at. So Kyle, I'm just going to turn it over to you. And thanks, brother, for sharing tonight and what you're going to share. So it's all yours.
You bet. Thanks, Phil. Yeah, Phil, as Phil mentioned, he had talked to me a while back about talking on leadership tonight. And I just wanted to start with, I in no way am pretending that I'm any kind of a guru on leadership. I know that many of us listen to podcasts, we read books. Phil does a great job of keeping us resourced with leadership materials. So I thought tonight, instead of just quoting everybody else that we've already have that information at our fingertips, I may use a quote here and there, but a lot of it is things that I've learned either the hard way or someone else has told me, or something we just were able to figure out. Some of these things you already know, so they'll just be reminders, but need to be covered. And then there might be something that can help you. And then I work best through collaboration, so I want to learn from you as well. So I'm thinking maybe I'll go through two or three of these and then stop and maybe you get your feedback or something I can learn from or something we can dialogue about, and we'll just work our way through it. So with that being said, I just basically, obviously, we're just talking about 10 things tonight. In no way, obviously, is this an exhaustive list of things that, you know, cover leadership. But again, they're just a few things that I felt like are important and have good reminders for myself as well. So we'll just kind of get into it tonight. Here's the first thought. Good leaders value soul care. Good leaders value soul care. Again, that's nothing new, but it is something we need to be reminded of. As a leader, we're called to find time that works best for us and be consistent. And I think we all need to be reminded that God speaks best to us in the quiet place. And I don't know if anybody needs to hear that tonight, but it's impossible to consistently pour out of an empty, or it's impossible to consistently pour water out of an empty cup. And so I know Phil's talked strong about that. I know many of you teach that same stuff to your congregations and that kind of a thing, but it also applies to us. Tim Martin did a really good job last week at our meeting talking to us about prayer and about keeping our cups filled. And so, again, not to just quote everybody else, but Phil's talked a lot about people that have left the ministry because of that right there. They're just not taking care of themselves. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that one. I feel like that's one we all know, but something that, you know, we need to hear again. So good leaders value soul care. Okay. Number two, good leaders understand how important setting and protecting culture is. Good leaders understand how important setting and protecting culture is. And I wanted to just kind of give you a silly example of what I'm talking about here. You know, everybody's context is different, but when I stepped into the role that I'm in now in 2014, you know, we still had a lot of things that needed to be addressed. And again, just a goofy example, but we had a lady in our church who sold Avon, and she thought it would be okay to just to put Avon books out all over the church. And so all kinds of examples like this, and many of you have dealt with similar things to this. So one of the things that we wanted to implement for us is company is coming. All of you can relate to you're getting ready for the holidays and you're going to have family in town. And I don't know how you guys are, but my wife, I mean, she wants everything to look really nice if people are coming over. Company is coming. We get that. And so I just began to share that with her and with our church that our culture, kind of setting the culture, that wasn't the culture that we had as a church, but moving forward, we are going to have the mentality that company is coming. We have people that are coming over. We're not here to network market. We're not here to sell Avon. We're not here for any of those things. We're here to worship. And so that diffused it. You know, we didn't have to go into this big, long thing. So in your setting, and that's just an example, but there's things that are even more important than Avon books that need to be set. We've all heard the statement that Andy Stanley talks about, that people value character, but they follow clarity. And so in your setting, clarifying what those wins are and clarifying where you're going and what you're doing is important. That's setting the culture. But then the second part is protecting the culture. And you're going to have times along the way, obviously all of us do, where we have to protect that culture. One of the best ways to set culture is to find ways to talk about it, both directly and indirectly. So here's an example. Many of you know that Pastor Sean and Brooke are feeling called to go plant a church. And so in the meantime, we're looking for someone else. And so protecting the culture that we have there and have in Pittsburgh, rather than focusing on, we're in a moment of transition, we celebrated the fact that in 3 years, they saw 73 salvations in Columbus. So just reminding our folks that in the midst of COVID, in the midst of not knowing who's going to be the next person over there, God is winning. Things are taking place. So I would just encourage you with that, to set and then protect that culture, explaining to people how you're winning, celebrating those wins, celebrating that when people are, you know, when we're hitting what the culture is about. So another, just a couple of examples there. Protecting the culture in our church means not everyone gets the mic. Not everyone gets to get up and give an announcement. And not everybody gets to make an announcement that they want to make. So in our setting, if you don't give us the announcements a week before, they're not going in the announcements. And sometimes we just have to look at people, again, protecting the culture, protecting company being there. We don't need 6 minutes of announcements for people. You know, so we find other ways to do it. So we set the culture and we protect the culture. Before I go any further, does anybody have any thoughts on that, or maybe some ways that you have experienced those things? All right, we'll keep going. All right, number three, good leaders realize that one of their most important roles is being the head cheerleader for their staff, their people, and their community. So our attitude and outlook is contagious. And one of your greatest roles and one of my greatest roles is to believe in what Jesus can accomplish in someone else. And so, I'm not pretending that you don't already know this, but just as a reminder today, I see that as one of my most important roles, is to be an encourager to people, to champion other people, staff and people. So here's another thought I had along under that thought. Our job isn't just to delegate the stuff that we don't like doing, but to cheer and encourage and equip the right folks to do the things that we enjoy doing as well. It's real easy when you're cheerleading for someone, as long as they don't come into contact with some of the things that you enjoy doing. But I believe we're called to equip others. So just to give you a little example about that, we have a couple staff members here. Some of you know Adam Parrish, and you know, well, I don't know if you know Jeannie, our children's pastor, but both of them are gifted communicators. They really are. And if I was just being honest with you, being vulnerable for just a second, both of them are can in some ways communicate just as well, if not better than me. And rather than putting them in the corner and feeling intimidated by someone who can do something as well as I can, giving them the platform to use their gifts and to use what God's called them to do. Now, I recognize not everybody on the screen necessarily has staff, but you might have some people in your church that are gifted in ways that you are also gifted in. But as you know, our job isn't to just do all the ministry. Our job is to equip and encourage and empower people to come alongside us and do the work of, you know. So anyway, I just would encourage you with that today. Be the head cheerleader for the staff. Be the head cheerleader for your folks. Be the person that's encouraging people. Any thoughts on that one? Maybe to get some dialogue, maybe one or two of you tell me how you encourage, what's a small thing you do to encourage your people? I know Phil shared with me that he gives out M&Ms to some of the volunteers, the greet. What are ways that you, just little things you do to encourage? I'm okay with
silence. One of the simple things that I do, which is an everyday thing, is not grandiose at all, is I always try to make it a point to introduce people. Something simple. Phil was down the other day, and one of the daughters of somebody came in, and I'm introducing her. Phil, you remember Tiffany, and just little things like that, always recognizing that they're there. And if I'm talking to somebody, when they walk in, I introduce them, with, you know, this is, you know, our treasurer, she does great. I'm always complimenting them in front of other people. So even a simple introduction, I think, can go a long way.
Good. Anybody else? Ways you encourage. Fred, you do a really good job with that, with the NYI. What are some ways you encourage your folks?
A lot of times it's just the small stuff, you know, whether it's, you know, talking someone up or being encouraging to, you know, the people that are around. I always try to make a point, even though people on the council don't look for recognition themselves, I always make sure they're recognized and thanked for the hard work that they also do, that it's a team. It's not just individuals. And the reason I look good is because they are really the cogs that make it happen. And I'm a big proponent, like you, Kyle, of just, you know, equipping, releasing, being a big provider at whatever they need, and working from the background to make sure they succeed and make sure the ship stays afloat. We're either all going to float together or we're all going to sink together.
Good. One of the things in talking with Dustin that he's done, and I've done it in the past, I stole the idea from someone, but is doing like a volunteer appreciation night. One year we got a gift. I mean, you can do it a million different ways. I'll just tell you what we did. We purchased, has anybody been to Big Cedar Lodge or heard about it? We purchased an overnight stay for two at Big Cedar Lodge. And we had a drawing. So every volunteer put their name in the hat for that. But you know, and then we also had we have a local restaurant people like to go to. So we put several gift cards in from there and, you know, and then we just drew out different names and we tried to make it to where everybody got something. Phil, you obviously do that with our pastors. So just ways to make them feel valued. Another time that we encouraged them, we had a volunteer of the week deal. And so I'm just going to be honest with you. We did it out of struggling with volunteers. We started thinking, you know, are we valuing our volunteers enough? Do they just feel like we're just asking more and more out of them and not appreciating them? So we did this thing for a time where we would focus on a children's leader of the month or the week, and we'd bring them up and give them a little something and tell them thank you. And that went over really well. And I agree with what Fred said. It doesn't always have to be a big thing, but I would just ask all of us, myself included, is there something you can do just to encourage and be someone's cheerleader? Okay. Number four. And this is near and dear to my heart. I feel like this is one that we've had to deal with at times. Good leaders realize that handling conflict effectively, I want to emphasize the word effectively. Good leaders realize that handling conflict effectively is an essential tool for leadership. In my experience, the leader's ability to handle conflict effectively is critical to a church's health. In a given situation, all of us, because of how we're wired, have a tendency to either over-address it or under-address it, if that's a word. But the right answer, as you know, is to seek the Lord's guidance and deal with the situation. One of our kids, I don't even remember which one of our kids, I think it was my daughter, when she was little, she could not blow her nose for nothing. We tried to show her how to do it. She couldn't do it. And a lot of times what would happen is that little bitty innocent cold would turn into this, you know, sniffles would turn into this great big issue because she couldn't deal with, you know, she couldn't just blow her nose. And again, just my experiences, a lot of times when situations come up and we tend to want to ignore them, most of the time it's going to end up becoming a bigger deal than it needs to be because we don't address it. And then at the same time, if we, just being real, with my oldest son, I'm new, you know, my youngest son, I'll have more experiences, but with Noah, I'm learning on the fly. So sometimes I tend to overdress it to make sure I do address it. And, you know, as a pastor, sometimes we'll come up against situations where we've never been through them before. Maybe even district superintendents are that way. I don't know. But you go through things and you don't know what you're doing, for me first, and you can overaddress it too. And that'll kill the church. So I also realize that I come from a blended family and I come from a broken home. My parents divorced. And I was probably 30, 35 years old when I realized that not everything about my childhood prepared me to be a great parent. I'm going to have to learn some new things. And just because we got our ordination paper or we graduated from a school doesn't mean that we're equipped to handle every conflict that comes our way. And sometimes conflict, this happens to me a lot. I'll go to someone, it might be Phil, it might be Adam, it could be Pastor Jim, who used to be the pastor at our church. And I will just say, I don't know how to fix this. What are your thoughts? In AA, the first step to recovery, we all know what it is to admit you got a problem. So the leader that it doesn't think they have any problems, that's dangerous. It's the leader that's willing to say help, you know. So I would just encourage you, if you don't feel equipped to handle conflict, just be honest about that. Don't pretend you know. Be honest about it and seek someone out who you trust to help you through that process, because we've all been there. Just to make everybody feel better, because I know somebody in here, there's too many of us, have handled, you know, are dealing with conflict now. How many of you feel like at one point you needed advice from somebody else? Just slip your hand in the air. Okay, yeah. Everybody's being honest. So, you know, that's just the way it is. Okay. Phil, is there anything you'd like to add to that, or anybody else for that matter, on the conflict thing? I know you've had to deal with that a lot.
Yeah, actually, I've been reading two books on the conversations to have and all of that. So I'm right with you. I think you're right on track. So I don't need to say anything. You're hitting home run.
Okay. So a couple of things.
Can I say something there or ask something about that? So yeah. I'm going to tell a little story here. It's long ago about Phil. Somebody mentioned something, and I don't know what they were talking about. They said that Phil didn't like conflict. And so I asked him out. I was like, so Phil told you he didn't want to deal with something? Well, no. I said, wait, have you approached him? Well, no. I said, oh, so you think Phil's not approachable? He was like, well, no. I said, well, don't you think it's kind of unfair to at least not bring it to him, right? Like to give him a chance. And then I've always had that in the back of my mind. And so I guess being approachable is like extremely important because you have to catch conflict early and you want to deal with it up front and deal with it early. But my question in all that, in saying all that, other than the joy of being long-winded, is that I've never like addressed that point to even the board that I recall. I mean, I automatically assume my board and everybody knows that I'm approachable. They can bring anything they want to me, but I've never actually been purposeful about communicating that to the board.
So
yes, please.
So forget about being a pastor. Just I'm married. There are many times that I think I'm clear with my wife and she says I'm not clear.
Right.
And there's times where she thinks that she's clear with me and I'm not clear. You're supposed to go pick up Grace. I never heard that, you know. So I guess where I'm going with that is assuming is a very dangerous thing as a leader.
Yes. So that's my question is then, should we create like be purposeful about it and have a conversation that, you know, hey, I'm approachable, you know.
Yes,
like
I think.
Set a space out in the board meeting or something where we have, hey, this is complaint time, or hey, what are we hearing? Let's get ahead of anything that may be going on, or we have a good way to structure a board meeting or something.
I think to just simply tell your people, you know, I mean, like I said, I'll tell my kids, there's nothing that you could ever tell me that would make me not love you. There's nothing, board, that you can't approach me with. Now, I might not agree, but I want you to be heard. I want you to feel heard. Folks, there's nothing, you know, if that's how you feel, if you want them to be able to approach you, that, which is a healthy thing, then you should just tell them. Just communicate, you know, just tell them. I told Whitney, I'm not a mind reader. Just tell me what you're thinking and I'll, you know, let me know what you're thinking. So I think sometimes we assume that we're clear, but if we're listening to our folks, they'll let us know if we're being clear. So if you are concerned that you're not being clear enough, then just tell them, my concern is that I'm not approachable. I want to be approachable. I just want you to know that. Does that help, Art?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I was just I had a thought run through my head, and sometimes I can't contain them.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other thoughts on that?
Hey, Kyle.
Yeah, John.
Just from experience of a situation that I've been through, something we don't often think about, but especially depending on the type of conflict and what's going on, documenting that conflict is your friend. Having the ability to go back and say, this absolutely happened. Here's who was there. You know, these are the people that were there at the time. This is what was said. And being able to go back and show that will keep some fires from being lit. Because when conflict occurs, you will have people, and they will be people within your church that feel completely comfortable lying, that feel completely comfortable misleading, misdirecting, and think that the end justifies the means to get there. And I hate that that has to happen and does happen in a church where we are supposed to be focused on, you know, kingdom, God.
Right. You know, John brings up a good point. He started talking about heavy conflict, which, you know, where you have to have that really hard talk, which all of you have had at some point. And I know Phil says this all the time And Phil was really helpful with me when I was going through some stuff with our church. Sometimes you don't have that conversation alone. You know, you have that with someone else. One of the things that I learned the hard way over the years was I would try to Andy Griffith things, is a term I use. You know, Andy never used his bullet. He just kind of would talk with people and just kind of encourage him. But there's times where you gotta not use a bullet, but you'd like to, but but there's times where you gotta document it. And there was some situations where I tried to Andy Griffith it and it wasn't the right thing to do. I needed to document it. I needed to put it down. And it got me in not trouble, but it cost me because of that. So John, you bring up a very excellent point that to protect yourself and others, sometimes you need to document that. I think this is a big topic for all of us because conflicts, we'd do just fine if we didn't have to deal with conflict. So,
yeah, Kyle, I'll add in to that. Yeah. So here's what I'm finding out. Number one, I wouldn't meet with anybody without somebody in the room. Number two, I never would meet with somebody without taking notes. And I will take pages of notes in those conversations. And the third thing that I've learned in what we're talking about here is that what looks like a little issue to me can be a big issue to the other side of my desk. Mm. If I treat that issue as little to them, not only does it get larger, but it can explode. And so I think I need, when those issues come, I would encourage pastors to deal with them as quickly as you possibly can. You know, Gaither used to sing a song, we built the wall one hurt at a time. So I think people build their walls one hurt at a time, deal with the hurts, the way you don't have the walls. And then I would be very careful that you don't belittle that conversation and that hurt that's on the other side of the desk. You need to make sure that you hear them. And then finally, I would say when you finish, you triangle the conversation. So in other words, I think I've heard today you said, is that what you said? Or what is that correct? And or ask your third party that question. What I've heard today is this, is that correct? And so that everybody is in agreement that, you know, it's really easy for somebody to say to me, that's not what I said.
Right.
Oh, well, what did you say? Oh, I said this. Oh, I didn't understand that. Well, that question can solve a lot of grief down the road if you'll stay ahead of it.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Any other dialogue on that? Hey, I wanted to read you one quote that I think it's Lisa Turker said, but here's what it said. The secret to healthy conflict resolution isn't taking a you against me stance. The secret is realizing it's an us against Satan. He's the real enemy. And we've all heard that scripture, Ephesians 6:12, that says our struggle is not against flesh and blood. And I have to remind myself of that a lot, that our struggle isn't against people. You know, it feels like it a lot of times, but, you know, as pastors, you all know this anyway, but just a reminder to all of us that it's not against people. So if you're in the middle of something right now, the enemy is the real culprit. So, yeah. Okay. Before we move on from the conflict and move on to something else, was there anything else that you guys have on that?
Yeah, Kyle, I was in a church on staff where there was a lot of division in the church that was brewing. And what you just quoted from Lisa Turkhurst, we adapted a slogan and put it up around the church building on just 8.5 by 11 sheets of paper that said, my brother is not the enemy. My brother is my brother. The enemy is the enemy. And that really helped us when we were in disagreement with people and we're trying to work out our differences. It really helped us to realize we have an enemy that's trying to destroy us as God's church and his people. And we're not at odds with each other, but there is an enemy that's trying to put us that way. But we will, with grace and the help of the Holy Spirit, we're going to work through this.
So to steal that, Fred is setting culture in his church with saying that. He is setting culture both in statement, you know, what he's saying, and then by putting it somewhere where people can see that whatever's going, is it on the wall? Is it like a picture or something or a statement? That picture is teaching every time someone walks by it and looks at it. That's excellent. That's good. Fred, I'm going to steal that and take credit for it.
You can.
Oh, anything else on that? Anybody? Okay. All right. Well, here's another one. Good leaders hog the blame and share the credit. Good leaders hog the blame and share the credit. So don't throw your staff or your folks, your people, your church, your lay folks, don't throw your staff or your folks underneath the bus to save your skin. Have their back. And again, I want to brag on Phil. Phil does that for me all the time, has our back. And I hope that's not just something he does for us, but that's something that we model. There's not a faster way to lose trust is not to have somebody's back when you need to have their back. So hog the blame and share the credit. Anytime that you're tempted to take the credit, remember someone else helped make it possible. We aren't here to be served, but to serve, Jesus said. I want to share a story with you that you guys might know. You guys might have had something similar happen to you. One of my things is sometimes I'm able to have ideas. And one time I was in a setting where I shared a couple of ideas. I wasn't the leader. I was just a person. And I shared those ideas. And then the person in charge implemented the ideas and then took credit for the ideas. And it didn't really matter from the standpoint that it just helped the overall group, you know, anyway. But it bothered me. You guys ever had that happen where you know what I mean? So what I've realized over the years is, and you probably have too, very, very seldom am I the smartest person in the room. And if I'm always the smartest person in the room, then I'm not leading very well. You have people that serve with you or work with you or that, you know, attend church, they have some good ideas. They have some good thoughts. And when they give them to you and you implement them, give them credit for it. You know, take the credit for it or take the credit for it. Give them the credit for it. Pastor Adam, who I work with, if he'll ever give me a sermon idea, I'm really good. I try to say, hey, Adam gave me this illustration, or, you know, Adam, this was Adam's thought, or Jeannie shared this with me, or I was talking to Beth Wells, a layperson in the church, and she said this. Part of that, it's equipping them and giving them the credit. Any thoughts on that? Or I'm sure we've all experienced things like that before. So anytime you're tempted to take the credit, remember someone else helped make it possible. Okay, number six, and this kind of goes along the lines of number five, but just a little bit different. Good leaders are more interested in the right idea than they are at having to be their idea. Good leaders are more interested in the right idea than they are that it has to be their idea. So what do I mean by that? Here's what I mean. Create a culture where people always have a voice. Create a culture where people always have a voice. Find ways to use other ideas when possible. So I'm a Chiefs fan, and the Chiefs have a receiver named Josh Gordon, and they are trying to find ways to get him the ball so he can get some confidence, because he has talent, but he just hasn't, you know. Find ways to use the ideas that some of your folks have. This is another thought I had. Folks will get tired of collaborating if it really isn't collaborating. So years ago, we used to have staff retreats. And people got, our board members got tired of going to those staff retreats because none of the ideas were getting implemented. So, hey, real quick, my son's at the door. I'm going to give him my truck keys and I'll be right back. Be right back.
Well, we could all prank him and just go off screen. That'd be terrible. I don't even know why I thought that. I rebuke you, Satan. You guys will do that to me. That's why I'm scared of it. It's like, you're all rascals.
Sorry, my son's getting ready to go spend the night at grandma's and he did it into my truck. So
now, are you giving him credit for that idea, or are you trying to take it for yourself, or what?
Yeah, I'm giving him the blame. That's okay. So folks get tired of collaborating if it really isn't collaborating. So I'm going to give you a little example. Right now we are down 3 staff positions here. And so I'm doing the lead pastor, and then I'm also doing the youth. And then Matt Williams, our college pastor, is also leading worship for Connecting Point. And a couple of our secretaries are doing a lot more because of we're down positions. And when right before COVID hit, we were going to build a building for a sanctuary. And 2 months into raising money, COVID hit and we just kind of stopped. And it's been in that mode. People are starting to come back now. But I have so much on my plate right now that if I wait till I have time to look at modifying that project, it'll be 6 months to a year down the road. So what I'm done is our worship leader, thanks son, see ya. Our worship leader, Brian, is extremely sensible. He's got a gift of construction and carpentry stuff. And so what I've done is I'm gonna let him take the lead on that project for the next couple of months, and he'll report back to me where it's at and what's going on, so that there can continue to be process taking place. So I really want to be involved in that, but I have to trust that he's going to come up with the right ideas as well. So not everything has to be my idea. Not everything has to be your idea. You have some smart people in the room, use their ideas. So any thoughts on that or experiences with that? Okay. Okay, here's another one. Good leaders understand how important processes and systems are to effectively reaching people. Good leaders understand how important processes and systems are to effectively reaching people. So if there's not a plan, everybody will make up their own. And y'all know that. And that's called chaos. So in our setting, in our church, for about 2 years, we had a group of a team that was basically policies and procedures. And they covered everything from, are we going to charge if someone's getting married at our church, to who's locking up, what's our policy? I mean, just all kinds of things. So then every year, both campuses, it's the first week of January every year, both campuses get together and we go over our policies and our systems with all of our new leaders, as well as even our board and everyone. We cater in a dinner for it. We come up with funny skits that go along with it. We talk about things like 2 staff members who aren't, you know, we have a female staff person and a male staff person, you aren't to go to lunch together. You know, I mean, we cover a lot of different things. Because when you don't know what your policies and systems are, and you don't communicate what those policies and systems are, then, you know, you really can't grow, and it creates dysfunction. So it doesn't matter what size church you are. Obviously, the policies and systems change as something grows. But in your context, what are some policies and systems that you rely on, or what are some policies and systems you need to implement? So I would ask you guys that just as a question to talk about. Give me a policy or system you implemented that worked well, or would somebody have the courage to say, hey, here's something we need to implement a little bit better at?
One of the areas that we've had to address is what do you do with people calling for needing help, aid? And the way it works best for me, empathy is not one of my strongest giftings. And so I want a board leader to take charge of that and then choose a committee that they'll work with. And I'm able to say then, as people approach me as the pastor asking for help, and say, we have a group of people that work with that, and it's not me. And that has been a great relief to me. But just authorizing them with a fund to draw from and ways to meet needs, but I don't have to make those decisions.
That's excellent. That's excellent. Maybe somebody else.
Kyle, one of the things we had to do here at Scenic when we expanded our children's department from one kid to 10, we wanted to make sure that my wife, who's downstairs doing the children's department, is safe. And so we actually have somebody upstairs that is in our lobby at all times. So if anybody comes in, instead of that we don't know, we have somebody who's going to divert them away from the staircase to go downstairs to make sure that it's not a potential problem or anything like that. And only the parents or authorized people are allowed downstairs to get the kids and not anybody else during services or anything like that.
That's good. That's good. So one of the things that we did, kind of along with similar to John, is we started having children show up. So our children's ministry stuff on Wednesday starts at 6:30. Probably yours is similar to that. And we would have parents dropping their kids off at 5:45, 6 o'clock, and we don't have adults around. Well, you can't really do that at a school. So we just implemented a rule, and it was hard at first. Pastor Jeannie helped us with that. Just basically, you can drop off your kids at 6:15. If you drop them off before 6:15, you'll have to be with them, or they're going to have to wait outside. We don't have enough people here. And that's to help us. If someone were to come in and get abused or fall and hurt themselves or something happen, and we could be liable. So systems and processes are valuable. And also systems and processes allow for fun. You know, if you have structure and you have Fred, I think that's one of your strengths. You know, just it's been several years since I worked with you, but that's a wheelhouse of yours, in my opinion. So I think sometimes the reason churches don't grow is not because the pastor is not a good enough people person. It's because they don't have systems and policies in place. Any thoughts on that? Anything else?
Yeah, we have a contingency for literally everything under the sun. And the reason we have that is because we have very little written down. And so I've noticed that we think we have more than we do. We actually don't have none of that stuff written out per se. So that's been one thing that I've been challenging myself and the board with, is that we need to be able to take somebody to a policy that we say we have. If it's not in black and white, we don't have it. So we don't have a policy if it's not written down. So that's one huge thing we're going to be undertaking in 2022, is actually putting all that stuff together.
You know, if anybody would like a copy of our policy handbook, Kelly Rhodes, some of you know Kelly, he helped us. We stole from him, honestly, with some of it. But if you would like a copy of that, we can get you one. And it just covers a lot of things that you don't always think about. Tim, would you like
I think I would like one of those.
What's that?
I would like one of those, please.
Okay, Austin and Tim. All right. Yeah, we can get that to you.
And
if
and Art.
And Art?
Art, don't forget about Art. Yeah, out there on the wings. He's the guy with the beard out there.
We'll get it to you.
I just want to, this is Chad, add to that. One of the things that policies and procedures, the benefit of that is it helps everyone from the same page. And, you know, if a new board member, if they don't know where the policies and procedures can be located, or if they don't believe it's something that's important to read through, it, you know, it's most policies and procedures are good cures for insomnia. But you know, if something were to happen, I followed a pastor in Farmington, Arkansas that died of cancer, and it was a small church. Nathan Heck in Garden City followed pastor, and they didn't even have passwords written down. And so it was a lot of fun trying to get into, you know, utility accounts and different things. And so having a policy and procedure helps, you know, if something were to happen to your outreach director or someone, the next person could come in and have, you know, at least something in writing so that they can get on the same page. Same thing for even your events and activities. Well, how do we do this? You know, and did we get outside funding? Did the church family fund the whole thing? Did we collaborate? We have our policies and procedures available through our website. Members can go to the I'm a Member tab, and they can scroll to the bottom, and they can bring up the policies and procedures right there. So it really helps communicate.
In fact, I'll check that out for myself. I'm not opposed to stealing some ideas. So, hey, I want to back up. Fred said something to the group earlier that's really good. Again, Fred, I'm going to take credit for it and say I said it. No, I'm just kidding. But he said, sometimes you have to eat crow when it's not your crow to eat. That's really good. So, Fred, who told you that, or did you come up with it on your own?
I had to learn that the hard way.
Hard way.
School of Hard Knocks.
There you go. There you go. Okay. Here's one that is a little bit off the beaten path, but I've learned, and I can't remember. I think Andy Stanley said this one. I don't know if he said it exactly like this, but here's what I think he was trying to say. Good leaders realize how heavy their words are. Not everything needs to come from you. So I'll give you a couple of big extremes. I'm going to give you a big thing that doesn't need to come from you, and a little thing. So a little thing, we have somebody on our custodian on staff. There was a mess that needed to be cleaned up. And in the past, if I would tell him that, he has a supervisor, our office manager is actually the one that's over him. And I could tell it would crush him when it came from me. And so I started realizing our office manager's name is Veronica, just saying, hey, Veronica, you know, such and such, could you tell him this area of the building isn't quite clean enough? We need to clean it again. And he would take it a little bit better from her than he would from me. So realize how heavy your words are. Not everything needs to come from the very, whoever's, you know, the top person. And then the other thing is sometimes your words are too heavy when you're dreaming about something. Maybe you as a pastor are thinking about planning a church, or you're thinking about getting new carpet, or you're thinking about adding a contemporary service, but you're not ready to pull the trigger on it. You can't tell everybody that information because they don't realize you're just thinking about it and dreaming about it. They think it's going to happen. And then number one, they're telling everybody, right? Or number two, they're overanalyzing it. So given Andy Stanley credit for that. He said that not everything needs to come from him. And I found that to be true, that not everything in your church and your setting, sometimes your words are too heavy. I think we all can admit that it's scary sometimes how much influence we have with people and just recognizing that. Phil, would you have anything to add to that or thoughts on that?
Yeah. So the longer you're at a church, I'll stay with your word. The longer you're at a church, the heavier your words become. And so when you say something and you're in the thinking process, it often is translated as that is the what we're going to do. And people will walk out of the room going, we're going to, you know, we'll stay after your deal. So heavy, and we're going to go start a church. And that's not what you said, but that's not what they heard. And often you have to go back and try and fix that, you know. So, and that can be done 1,000 different ways. But I think that is longevity of a pastor. The longer you are, the larger your church is, the more you have to be very careful what's said in those settings. Sometimes you just need to not say anything.
And for those of you who maybe have staff or some really key lay leaders, even with them, I found that I would sometimes overwhelm. I'll just use Jeannie as an example, who just started. You know, she's learning to do kids ministry. She doesn't need to be burdened with some crazy / stupid idea that I'm thinking about. It overwhelms her. So identify who are those people that you can dream with and you can, like Phil said, think and process with, and who are the ones that it's just too much for them. And I'll just be honest with you. My wife is not someone, like when I first came to her and said, I think God is calling us as a church to plant a church in Columbus. She wasn't negative about it, but she was just, it was like, oh, you know, like what, like just change. Of course, once it opened and she's seeing what's going on over there, it's extremely exciting, but you have to know who you can dream and process with and who you invite into the process a little bit later once things have been, you know, thought through a little bit. Is that, I'm sure that makes sense to people. Okay. I have one more on your sheet.
Can I dig into this here real quick, just half a second? So I have personal relationships with people and I know how I can talk with them. And the more time you can spend, you know, individually with your board members, developing relationships, great thing. It's been a huge learning curve for me, like especially down in Buffalo, but I've been trying to set specific times aside for things like brainstorming in the board meeting, because we're all together there and I don't have to keep track of who I've spoken with about it. And so I've got these segmented times in the board meeting where that's what it's for. And so I just want to make sure that I'm not hearing, don't do that, right? So that's not what you're saying. There is a time for brainstorming, but those flighty, because I talk all the time, and I've noticed that you have to be careful who you say that to, because they'll run with it like it's gospel. But you're not saying that that shouldn't be in the board meeting, just a clarifier, correct?
So one thought I had is, I learned this the hard way, don't turn for the, and Phil, you can disagree with this if you think differently about this, but I would try to avoid turning board meetings into dream sessions. You know, if we're going to have a big dream session, we usually will schedule that like on a Saturday morning from 9 to noon, kind of a deal that's set aside. Because if your board's getting out of board meeting at 10 or 11 o'clock because you've tried to get through your stuff and then start dreaming about stuff, that's just too much. So what we normally do, Art, is keep a board meeting for the most part. I mean, sometimes you might say, hey, I don't want to get sidetracked, but here's a thought we can think about later. But for the most part, if you're going to spend time thinking about what could be, you want to schedule that separately. Did I answer your question, or did I go off on a different path.
No, that's right. I just, at the end of the board meeting, you know, I set time aside for thoughts, you know, is God, you know, putting something on your heart? Is, you know, it's not really a, you know, a dream session or anything like that. And our board meetings typically last about an hour. They're not overly long, but I take your advice. I mean, that's good, solid advice. And with all the things that are in my brain that I'd like to put in my board meeting, that's real good advice for me. So that's great advice. Thank you.
You know, our one
we do at our church. I'm sorry. At our church, if we've got something, if I have something that I feel like the Lord has placed on my heart that we need to accomplish, I'll send out the board meeting because I want them to be in prayer for. And then we'll spend just.
Is she cutting out for everybody else or just me?
Yeah. Shana, try that again.
Can you hear me?
You're cutting out really bad. Can you try that again? No, you're still cutting out.
I think she was talking about having an agenda ahead of time so that people can look through things. I think that's a good idea. I know.
And she was talking about sending out an email so people can be in prayer about it. If yeah. The Lord's really weighing something on your heart, but that's good. Yeah. But you started to say something, man. What yeah. was it?
Art, this is something I would encourage you with because just listening to you a little bit, you and I think similarly. I tend to be a little bit ADD and I have lots of thoughts, but I don't always know how to organize them. And so in a board meeting setting or even in a staff meeting setting, if I'm not careful, if I'm honest with myself, I can be a little bit all over the place. And so what I've done is I've had some people that aren't that way. I've got a couple people on staff that help me organize my thoughts and keep it concise. And we, for a while, we had a hard time getting board members. I think it's because board meetings were lasting too long. So find someone who has that skill that you don't have that can help you. You know, you can kind of word vomit all over them, all these ideas that you have. But then they can kind of take all that narrative and make it more of like an outline or a bullet point thought that you have. And when they would do that for me, I'd look at that and I'm like, yeah, that's what I'm, yeah, that's it. And plus it gives them, you know, using that person in that way helps them use their gifts and their talents. So, you know, that's one way where you can bring someone alongside you to help you. Most pastors, nope, it's got to come from me. I, you know, to just be honest and say, hey, I can have way too many ideas. Well, have somebody help you with that, think through them. That's just a thought.
Okay. I guess I'm missing, you know, speaking or something. I'm trying to lay aside time for them to convey what we don't normally talk about in the course of a day. So if the Lord's laying something on their heart, if they have an idea about, you know, anything in the church, how do I structure time for them? I'm not talking about me per se in that. I just meant for the board in general.
How do you structure time for them?
Well, that's what I mean. I have like 3 or 4 minutes at the end of a board meeting where I ask them, you know, is there any ideas we've talked about? Just that one little section where I ask them, you know, is the Lord leading you in any particular direction? Do you have any ideas that we've not implemented? Ideas about stuff we can put in place? It's just that one segmented time where we could talk about that so the board can convey that to me. It's just a form of communication. Our board meetings have an agenda. They're structured. They seldom last an hour. I mean, and they're not all over the place. So maybe I misspoke, but that was primarily for the board to be able to convey those things that they wouldn't otherwise talk about is kind of what I was getting at, I guess. But maybe
I missed you. What I heard there, I'd say what you're doing then is fine. If you're not spending a ton of time, what I was getting at is if you're taking up an hour or two of your board meeting time to dream and that kind of a thing, that gets long. But if you're just devoting a few minutes to it, you know, I don't think that's a big deal.
Hey, Art, what I do twice a year is I take my staff and board out on a Saturday on a dreaming session, and I'll take them somewhere special that normally don't go, out in God's creation somewhere. Like this past fall, we went down to Lake Tenecomo. I rented a pontoon for a half a day, and the board and I just went out on the pontoon, and we just did exactly what you're talking about. We just dreamed, you know, what if? We also took that time to evaluate what did we talk about 6 months ago and what got implemented, what was successful, and what didn't get implemented and why it didn't get it implemented. But I give them twice a year an opportunity on a Saturday to do that. That way it doesn't take up your board meetings, and because time is just valuable throughout the week. You know, we're at church multiple times during the week, and not being there any longer on a board meeting is a good thing.
Yeah. All right. Well, to respect your time here, I've got one more that's on the paper, and then I just had another thought with that. So here's number 10. Good leaders aren't tone deaf and can effectively identify what season they are in. So I don't know that we use the word tone deaf a lot, but in my thoughts, sometimes people can be tone deaf as leaders. So, and just to use our building thing as an example, we are not going to push a building program in the middle of COVID. You know, when we were back there, we're kind of coming out of that, but back there, it would have been tone deaf for us to just continue to push that. So for example, here's another thing. We're doing a Christmas Eve service this year. Phil's been pushing that, and we're going to do that. And our people for a while have been telling us, you know, that they would like one. Well, a lot of the reason we didn't do it was, you know, we were going to have to give up some of our family time, and just, it's one more thing we need to do. But rather than being tone deaf, kind of listening to our people and realizing this is the time to start it. People are interested in it. They want to do it. They've been isolated through COVID. This would be a great time. So one of the things I just wanted to say with that is identify what season you're in and recognize whether or not it's time to hit the gas pedal or it's time to hit the brakes. You can't be all gas pedal and you can't be all brakes. That's important. Any thoughts on that from anyone? I don't pretend that I'm the only one that, you know, can speak about any of these things. So any thoughts you have on that? Somebody asked number 9, good leaders realize how heavy their words are. Just being able to read the room is kind of what I'm saying. Okay, last thing. And it's funny, somebody talked about being approachable earlier. That's my last thing. And it's not on your sheet as we get out of here. Be approachable and adaptable. And Phil, you've been harping on this for a while, and I think it's true. If you aren't flexible during this COVID thing or just in general, you're going to have a hard time. Be fluid and be flexible and be willing to try new things and do new things and, you know, and don't be afraid to fail. I will tell you that fear is a real thing that you guys all, and the enemy wants, he's not going to get you as a pastor to denounce Christ, but he can fill you with fear. And there is a time, it's not fear. There's just a time sometimes where we have common sense and this isn't the right season. But I would just encourage you with the fact that there, God is going to call you to hit the gas pedal on something, and don't be afraid to do it. Be approachable, be adaptable. Don't be afraid to try new things. Don't be afraid to experiment. Some of you may know we started the homestead, which is basically we bought a house next to our property, and it became our property, and we flipped it, and we have college students in it. It was going like gangbusters, and then COVID hit. So instead of saying we're going to keep doing it the way we're doing it, we're experimenting with some different things to see if it, you know, we can figure it out. So just because you've always done it the way you've done it, don't be afraid to try something new. So Phil, that's all I have. If anybody has any thoughts or questions or something that I can learn from, let me know.
All right, Kyle, it's been great. Thank you. Thank you. And I know everybody's giving the thumbs up and applauding. Way to go. Great night. Great night. So let's have a word of prayer. And Doug, Jacket, why don't you pray for us? And as the season comes in for Christmas, pray for that. And then these three issues of Josh Lean, Bill Whetstone, and Haley Rose. Let's, if you don't mind, lead us to the throne.
God, we just come to you right now. Father, we're so thankful. God, we're just so thankful for what you've given us. As many of us have reflected probably over this last year, as this year's winding down. God, we're just so thrilled, God, with the work that you're doing in the midst of these hard times. And God, we do want to just offer you praise and thanksgiving from the bottom of our hearts, God. And all too often we jump in and with requests and our want list, God. And God, I just feel heavy tonight as we went through this. And I know other pastors have been dealing with difficult times and situations within your church, God. And so I pray right now for each one that's on this call or will be viewing it later, God, that you just do a work in the life of them individually. And in the life of the church, God, that many things will come out of this, and we won't let anything get us down or distract us, God. That we will continue to look to you, God, and God, that even though we know that we'll be faced with hard times and conflict, God, that we look for you in these times, and you know, that we trust, God, that in everything, that we do, God, that you have gone before us, and we are just trusting and obeying and following God in your footsteps. And God, we do now, God, just come to you and ask for your healing touch on these three, God. And we lift up Josh's son to you right now, God. And we don't know all the details, God. And we just got word today that it's just not right now, God. And so we need, God, we're just asking that you touch this body, that you bring healing to the area that needs to be touched and healed, God. And we are claiming victory over this right now, God. We're just claiming victory that you will touch his body and heal what needs to be healed, God. We think about Bill and what he's been through, Father, God, I just give you praise for being able to see him a couple weeks ago God, that what you've done so far in his life, and he's trusting in you, God, but he continues to need your touch. So we're asking, God, that you continue to intervene in his healing process, God. And as we've gotten word today, Father, for this one that has COVID now and is struggling, and Father, I pray that you go to the bedside right now and that. You, God, do the work that you can do, and you provide that touch, God, that of comfort and that peace, God, that passes all understanding. Father, I pray, God, that you just feel that area, that the nurses and the doctors begin to feel something different, God, in that in the end of this, God, that that this living testimony will come out of this, and lives will be changed because. God, of the touch that you've put on this body. So, Father, I pray as we continue this week and Christmas is fast approaching, God, I pray that those of us that will be traveling, God, that you provide traveling mercies, that you go before us, God, and clear the way, and God, that you bless our family time and all that we do and say. And I pray, God, that lives will be changed. One of the things that you've impressed upon my heart, God, is that if we just share our story, and many of us will be with family members this week that need to hear a testimony about the work that you've done in lives, God, we all have family members that need you. And so I pray that you would use somebody's testimony this week, God, to penetrate the hearts and lives of family members, that somebody's life would be changed this week because, God, of the work that you've done and that you continue to do in our lives, God. We love you tonight. Thank you for Phil. Thank you, God, for his leadership. Thank you for Kyle tonight, God, for taking this on. And and leading us through this and giving us food for thought and a challenge, God, that we need, and accountability. So God, would you just continue to be with us? We love you, and we just give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right. Hey, thank you again, Kyle. Great night, and Merry Christmas to all of you. All right. And God's richest blessings on you. We'll see you guys.